Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Welcome to Live It Up, the show where we explore and discuss how to take your life to that next level and beyond. We cover health, wealth, relationships, and how to create a life that feels good, because that's what we all ultimately want. We want to feel good. Hey, I'm your host and coach, Fletcher Ellingson, and to my right is someone for whom I'm always willing to schlep heavy items, Amy Ellingson.
Are you, though, all the time?
I said in my
vows.
In my vows to you.
It's true. Hey. Hi.
Good to see you here.
Yeah, you too.
We didn't even talk about coordinating colors.
I know, we're in black.
We're back in black again. Hey, today is a kind of a fun episode because it's our 100th episode.
Nice. Yeah.
So before we talk about that, let me just finish this introduction and then we'll get to that, okay?
Okay.
So before we go on further, I just want to remind you that if you are out there listening and you have questions that you would like us to answer on or off the air, you can email those directly to me at Fletcher@FletcherEllingson.com. You don't need to suffer. You don't need to try to figure it out all on your own, because there are answers and solutions and ways to get unstuck and move forward powerfully. And I also want to remind you that you can visit my website, FletcherEllingson.com. I've got a number of free resources there to check out. So visit me, take the happiness quiz, get my ebook, listen to the podcast, and stay in this conversation. All right, I look forward to hearing from you. So let's talk about the 100th episode.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, I remember when you had this idea and you wanted me to do it with you, which, I mean, anyway, it's just been really fun. I mean, sometimes it's been kind of a pain for me because, like, I work 4 days a week and have to come up with a show with you and look things up. I don't like to do things totally off the cuff all the time, especially if I'm answering questions. So
you do a really good job of answering off the cuff, though.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
But I was thinking about thinking back of, like, all the different patients that have commented, like, that we've seen you on TV, we see you and your husband on TV, and then the time when I remember we were at Costco and I had a mask on and this man recognized my voice from this TV show. Remember, that was so weird.
Yeah.
It's like he recognized my voice because I was just talking to you in line at Costco, and then we started talking to him and he was really interesting. And I just think, and then, like, at the airport here in Wenatchee, like, we saw our picture up and our kids were with us, and it's been fun to do it. And I feel like the feedback that I've gotten, at least from people that I've talked with, is that they look forward to it. It's made a difference for them. They've learned something. They enjoy it. And I hope that we really are adding value and some feel-good time to people's day.
Yeah, absolutely. And I always learn something. I mean, if you're on the show, I'm always learning something about the medical profession or health and vitality, and that's always cool. And I get to meet so many fun people that I get to interview,
yeah,
which is, I really love.
Yeah, you've had some really cool guests, and
yeah,
you've really highlighted people that are making a difference for the community and our planet. And
yeah. And I should say also, if you're listening and you know of somebody who has an interesting story, maybe they have a story of inspiration or triumph or victory, or maybe they're a cool entrepreneur, maybe they're doing something that's making a difference for the community, I would love to hear about them. So email me at Fletcher@FletcherEllingson.com. I'm always looking for interesting guests and interesting stories, because if I feel inspired, I want to bring that inspiration to you. If you feel inspired, let me know, and let's just continue to pay that forward. So yeah, get a hold of me if you got a cool story.
Do you remember how your idea started?
Yes. I think we came on to do a spot about the Diabetes Smackdown.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right?
With Dan.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And I thought, well, this is really cool. And then I thought, well, we have lots to talk about, and and we have lots of stuff we want to impart to our community. At least I did. And then you got on board. And so we approached Brenda, and I treated it as one of my rejection experiments at the time, which I was putting the rejection experiment. It was an era in my life where I was putting myself into very specific conversations and making ridiculous or audacious requests where I would most likely be told no. And the reason I was doing this is because I wanted to become a master asker. I wanted to be able to ask for anything that I wanted in my life.
And it was a book that you were reading, which is really cool.
Yeah, the Bulletproof or
no, I thought it was called The Rejection Experiment.
No, it was. Anyway, but so I would make these requests where people would most likely say no. And it would make me really nervous, and I would sweat and perspire and chicken out sometimes. But anyways, this was kind of one of those. And Brenda said
yes.
Yes, sounds good. Let's do it.
And that was, I think, about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
So, and then we had a long time where we couldn't come in because of COVID, but yeah. Then we're back. So.
And now we're back. Yeah. Yeah. So today...
I just want to say thanks for everyone for being with us for 100 episodes.
Yeah.
And, hope you're having fun and enjoying it like we are.
Yeah, absolutely. So today we are going to talk about something that you and I have been talking about in our personal lives and kind of exploring this concept of doing hard things. And I think this is a really valuable conversation. It's been valuable for me just to have it in my kind of in my awareness, right? This concept of doing hard things, can we do hard things? And what the value is in that, and bringing an empowering story to the value hard things. So after the commercial break, we're going to talk about some hard things that we have faced individually and or together. I don't know which one, what you're going to share about, but encourage other people and let people know that they can do hard things too.
Yeah.
All right, stick with us. We'll be right back. Hey, everybody, welcome back to Live It Up. We are here on the 100th episode. Thanks for joining us and for helping make all this possible. And we are talking with Amy, and today we're talking about what?
Doing hard things.
Doing hard things.
And I wanted to share that the inspiration or the way we started talking about this was I read Glennon Doyle's book called Untamed, which was life-altering, and all of my friends that have read it have said the same thing, just beautiful, beautiful book. And then she has a podcast, which is also on video, but I tend to just listen to it, and it's called We Can Do Hard Things. And that's a kind of one of her mantras with her family and her wife is We Can Do Hard Things. There's even a song that for the podcast that her daughter wrote.
Oh, really?
And her daughter is singing, I think, with Brandi Carlile. They've recorded it. So that's kind of how the inspiration started, is doing hard things and doing hard things with awareness that you're doing a hard thing, and that kind of having the grace and the courage to move forward in that hard thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love it. I'm in the process of reading that book, and I agree, it's like so good. So many great nuggets in there.
Yeah, and that's interesting for you to say that. Not interesting, but I feel like as a woman, that book was so impactful, and so I'm actually interested to see how it lands for you, because a lot of what she talks about is kind of being raised as a woman in our country and some of the expectations and the way that we have been cultured. So
yeah,
anyway.
Yeah, definitely. So speaking of hard things, can you share, what's an example of something hard that you took on and grew from?
So one of the things that I thought of was that I left my job and practice in Chelan in 2019, and I had been there for 17 years and had my babies at that hospital and had been with people, you know, the same staff and some of the same providers and the same patients for 17 years, and I had been unhappy there for a little while, and but the thought of leaving was terrifying, and it was my first job out of residency, the only job I knew. Plus, there wasn't any other place like in Chelan where I could work. So, what am I going to do with, you know, kids at home and having to commute? And I wasn't sure what, you know, you get a paycheck, you have benefits, but you're not happy. It's like, so what are you going to do? And so, making the decision to leave Chelan was scary because of the unknown. It was scary because I knew my patients would be unhappy. I knew that I had to tell the CEO and tell my nurse and tell the staff and the other providers I'd worked with for, you know, 10 plus years. So you also, for me, I was worrying about disappointing people. Mm. And you know, how that was going to go. Then also for the kids that we have at home, it's like, I'll be home later, I'll have to leave earlier. How's that impact going to go? And so it was really uncomfortable. I had to have a lot of uncomfortable conversations and repeatedly uncomfortable conversations, you know, having to tell each of my patients whenever I saw them. But it was, in the end, I mean, it was a very empowering decision and has led to some really beautiful things, and I'm really happy professionally right now.
Nice.
Yeah, so that was a big deal. That was scary, and that felt hard. It was hard, but it was one of those things where it's like you're kind of coming to the edge of something and you have to make a hard decision, and then on the other side is this kind of freedom and empowerment and the ability to create something from scratch.
Yeah. Are you glad you did it?
I'm definitely glad I did it, yeah.
Yeah. Do you feel...
Yay, Three Rivers Family Medicine. Love you guys.
Do you feel stronger or more empowered as a result of doing that?
For sure, because it was like a sense of like my own life, my own decision, I'm going to make this for me.
Yeah, yeah, really good. Really
yeah.
Good.
And so what about you? How about you sharing one of your hard things?
Yeah, I think one of the hardest times of my life was, as you know this, but we'll recap it, was when I first moved over to North Central Washington from the coast. My first wife and I, we moved our business, manufacturing business, over here to Matson. We're very excited about it, threw ourselves into this, and we were manufacturing high quality all natural lotions and soaps and candles and lip balms, and we were wholesaling them to different places around the country and then retailing them from this destination farm that we were had our business set up at, and loved it, worked hard, but I definitely was lacking some business sense. And I thought, well, I'll just work harder and harder, and that didn't work. And then ultimately, we began racking up a lot of credit card debt for the business. And then our partnership, the people with whom we were partners, that relationship kind of soured and became very toxic. And it came to a head where we just made the decision to one day literally walk away. We packed up a few boxes and we just left. And we left with $20,000 worth of credit card debt, which is the worst kind of debt to have. We had a family of five at that point. We had a mortgage and zero income. And I remember we qualified for food stamps, and I remember going to Safeway in Chelan, and we used those food stamps one time. And it was at that point, and nothing against food stamps. They are for people who are in times of desperate need, and we were in a time of desperate need, but I remember kind of the sting or the self-judgment I had about it, and it was then like I declared, I will never be in this position again. I will find a way to dig our way out of debt and rebuild our family and provide. And that was extremely hard because my ego was involved. Talk about having to have hard conversations with like our business partners. I remember even having to like tell my wife, my mom, and that was like a hard. I was embarrassed, right? There was a level of embarrassment. There was a sense of failure. That was a hard period in my life. There was massive uncertainty, like how are we going to pay our bills and move forward? But we did, and ended up. You know the rest of the story, but that was one of the hardest things I've ever had to go through.
And so the same kind of question, do you feel like you came out the other side feeling more powerful or less powerful?
I didn't feel like, great, I'm empowered right now. But months down the road, and certainly a couple of years, I felt like massively empowered, mm-hmm. massively stronger and wiser and more prepared. You know, and using a lot more foresight and planning, and it also was a massive injection of personal development, which again put me on this trajectory of what I'm doing now.
And then, do you feel like it has you have more compassion or less compassion for people?
So much more compassion. I have so much compassion for entrepreneurs, and you know, as you know, a lot of my clients are entrepreneurs and business people, and I have so much compassion for them because I know what they're going through. I know what they're up against. The small businesses make up the backbone of our country. They are the engine. There are these big behemoths, you know, like Apple and Amazon and Netflix and all that, but it is still the mom and pop, small to medium sized businesses that are the engine of our country. And I have so much respect for them because I do have an inkling of knowledge about what they're going through.
And I think that's one of the beautiful things we talk about, where when you're in the middle of something hard, if you can actually just take a moment and be like, you know what, this is going to have me have more compassion for anyone who's going through this. I'm going to have wisdom from this. I remember one time I was really in a lot of pain emotionally after something had happened with a baby that I had delivered. And I remember someone telling me, it's like, well, this is part of the wisdom that you are acquiring. And mm-hmm. It felt so painful at the time. I mean, it still can feel painful, but it is a part of like the tapestry of our lives, that as we move through life, move through hard things, is part of the wisdom that we acquire.
Yeah, yeah. And so I just want to real quick, before we go to commercial break, say to you out there who are listening, you may be going through a hard thing right now. And we want to remind you that you can do hard things. You can do this. You have the capacity for it. Sometimes it doesn't feel like we have the capacity to take on anymore or go any further or carry that burden. I just want to remind you that you can do more than you may know you can do, and to stay the course, reach out, get help, get support. You can do hard things. We're going to take a quick commercial break and we're going to come back and talk a little bit more. So stay with us. Hey everybody, welcome back to Live It Up. So glad you're here. This is our 100th episode and we're talking about doing hard things. And I love this conversation. It feels really inspiring, and it causes us to gap backward, which we're doing now. So,
and I want to say one more thing too. Yeah. Is I know one time we talked about if the purpose of our lives is to avoid conflict and hard things, that is a place of like fear, and you want to shelter yourself all the time, and you're worried about a possible confrontation. But if the purpose of life is something else that we choose, whatever that may be, but something not avoiding hard things, avoiding conflict, avoiding, you know, those kind of armpit sweating conversations, then there's so much growth that's available. And so that's something that we've talked about too, is like, what if life is not about avoiding conflict and pain, but about whatever else you choose, like another purpose.
Anyway. I love that. So thanks for throwing that in. So what's another hard thing that you took on in your life?
Well, I was got divorced, and that was, that's the process started about 10 years ago, almost, you know, pretty close to the summer of 2011, and I had two small children at the time, and, that was definitely the most painful thing I've ever gone through my entire life. I remember this one day at work, I couldn't stop crying, and I just had to leave, and, like, I couldn't even really talk to say that I had to leave, and it was terrifying and so painful, pain, you know, my children showed the effects of the pain, and I couldn't sleep, I couldn't eat. It was, you know, yeah, one of the most painful things that I've ever, well, the most painful thing I've ever gone through in my life.
Yeah, yeah. And same question to you. As a result of going through that, are you less or more compassionate?
Oh, definitely. I'm just like a wealth of compassion for people that are either thinking about divorce or going through it or have gone through it, or huge, huge well of compassion.
Yeah, and do you feel, as a result of that, more empowered or less empowered?
I definitely feel much more empowered, because it was another opportunity, like when I left my job, where it was a decision to, live the life that I saw for myself and create a relationship with my girls, that because of that pain and that need to be so authentic and vulnerable, I think caused me to have a relationship that of just such depth with my daughters that I don't know that I would have had if we hadn't gone through that together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys are very, very close.
Yeah, I know. It makes me emotional because, yeah, we've just been through, we went through it, and it created, a bond that, anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, good stuff.
So I think in the end, it's so painful, but if you can look at the positives, it obviously, you know, I wouldn't have it any other way.
Yeah.
All right, it's the last one for you.
Okay. One of the other hard things I did was taking on triathlons, and that was a huge, huge one for me because I had such a limiting belief around it. I believed I was ordinary or average, mediocre, and I had a number of friends who were involved with triathlons and high-level fitness stuff, and I had never done any of that.
And I think you were eating, like, that was before you were with me, but you were eating poorly.
I was eating, yeah, very poorly. I was eating whatever I wanted, whatever tasted good, and I didn't.
Still thin,
and
by the way,
I didn't care about it.
Yeah.
But I secretly wanted to, like, exercise at that level—not exercise, but perform at that level—and have those experiences of challenging myself. But I just didn't believe I could do it. And when I got into triathlons, I could barely swim. I could jump off a dock and swim back to the dock and splash around. But if you asked me to swim there and the back in a Olympic distance size pool, I would have been hard pressed to do that, and I would have been out of breath. So I had to learn basically how to swim. So I finally said yes, because they kept on inviting me, and I was like, no, that's not for me, that's for other people, that's for the elite people. But I finally took it on and did and trained a 1 year to do my first triathlon, which was an Olympic distance triathlon. And after I did it, I felt elated. And then we decided to go on to the next level. And I did two or three Olympic distance. And then one of my friends was like, well, let's do the half iron. And I was like, the half iron? That's basically double what we just did. Are you crazy? And they were going to do it. I didn't want to be left behind. And I loved this sense of empowerment that I had found through training. And they said, well, just train, just don't say no, just train with us. So I trained, and then I signed up for the half iron and did the half iron. And I was, again, elated. I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't know that I had this within me. I felt so empowered. And then I was done. I was happy. That was enough, the half iron. That was a really good distance. And then they said it. Well, let's do the full iron. I was like, are you crazy? That's double what we just did. And they said, well, don't say no, just train with us. And so I trained with them. And then in 2011, I think, or 2010 or something around there, I did the Coeur d'Alene Ironman and completed that. And after that, my old belief systems had been shattered. I couldn't go back to them anymore. What I knew myself to be capable of had forever changed. And it changed my life in a big, big way. And yeah, I felt stronger and inspired and just capable. So.
And some of the stories you saw of people that did it also were so inspiring.
So inspiring.
That overcame so much to complete those.
Yes. Yeah. Really, really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's a good reminder that hard things, obviously they feel hard when you're in the middle of them. They're hard. But if you can kind of just take like a bird's eye view and just know what is on the other side is frequently wisdom, empowerment, a greater sense of compassion and greater clarity, and it's all kind of worth it, or you can make it worth it in the end. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Really good stuff. Hey, we're out of time here. So before we go, it's time to get out there. Be a source of kindness. Be a source of compassion. You do have something to offer this world, and we believe in you.